Crises can change the ways that we think about privacy as well as the legal protections for our privacy. In the wake of September 11th, the U.S. government rolled out a series of new surveillance programs intended to provide stronger protections against terrorism, which ended up having long-lasting and very far-reaching consequences for digital privacy. A Harris poll of 2,000 people at the end of March found that 60% of the people they spoke to supported giving government officials access to anonymized location data in order to ensure that people were actually complying with social distancing instructions. 71% of those people also said they'd be willing to share their own location data for alerts about whether they've been in close contact with infected individuals. And 65% said they would support a public registry that would show if their neighbors had tested positive for the coronavirus. There are already a number of initiatives underway in different countries to try to use people's location data or to use Bluetooth apps or to use facial recognition to enforce quarantine measures or perform contact tracing to track the spread of the virus. And it's important for us to be thinking now already about what the long-term ramifications those emergency initiatives designed to support public health will have for our digital privacy. That means trying to put in place safeguards now for those programs, thinking about how much data will be collected, how that data will be anonymized and protected, who will have access to that data, how long that will be stored for, what purposes it can be used for. If we're not thinking already about the long-term consequences of these programs, it's very possible that they will have very long-lasting and very far-reaching consequences that go well beyond the scope of the public health initiatives that they are aiming to support and affect our digital privacy in many other ways in many other areas as well.